So 2.5 years ago, at the ENOG 5 meeting in Odessa, we had a similar panel. Not everyone from this previous panel are present now here today, but some are. I'd like to introduce Vyacheslav Volk, Khmelnytsky, IXP. Then maybe I don't remember your name. Roman Venediktov, Data RX. Roman agreed to participate, therefore we'll have kind of two foreign participants. Unfortunately, he is not in the list which was prepared before. Alexander Alshansky, GigaNet. Edwin Pond, NLX. DTL, Mikhail Salikov, Kiev. Sergey Dina, DS Exchange. And Boris Borisov, UAIX. Maybe this is the first IXP. I collected some statistical data and they are more for public announcement. I'm not sure that everything is correct. The number of asterisks means here that I'm not 100% sure in the figures. But anyway, I indicate the number of platforms, the number of members, average and maximal part of the traffic, and the names of people who are present here today. Maybe this is not the most important data, because all data you can get from the website, but the most important is what we're going to discuss today. First, we have two short brief presentations. First is the UX Boris Borisov. As I mentioned, because it's one of the oldest, one of the kind of the first XPs, then we'll give him the floor, and then we're going to discuss it. Good afternoon. My name is Boris Borisov. I am the director of the Ukrainian exchange point. A bit of history. 15 years ago, some people from the company gathered together and decided that they should change their life. And they built the IX. And these 11 people actually were the official founders of that point. Some of you are present here and remember this historical moment, that it was quite difficult those times. Now we have the following IX, which consists of the one primary platform and two auxiliary platforms. They duplicate each other, and this ensures sustainability and stability in case of any changes. As many other businesses, we are now kind of surviving through quite difficult times. We have problems with economical situation in the country in general. Second challenge for us is our current legislation. We all heard what's going on with such companies and how these companies have to leave the territory of Ukraine, which means that the IX also is losing all its clients. Unless we get appropriate legislation, we can't talk about the appropriate development of the business. 6-7 ago, now we're quite a significant competition. Some time ago, we were the only one at the market. Now we have competitors, but it is good from the point of view of the user, because Ukrainian IXs, they kind of can, different, the variety can propose to the end user the stable situation. 15 years passed since we obtained our LIAR status, which would give us an opportunity to provide additional services and opportunities to our customers. Some time ago, we considered that the point shouldn't go beyond Kyiv, but those times have passed, and now we have a different strategy, and now we try to go already beyond the boundaries of Kyiv. At the pilot project, we have chosen Khmelnytsky for a number of reasons. Now we work on this pilot project. In case it's going to be successful, we plan to proceed to other cities, not big cities like small regional and district cities, because there is a demand on our services, as it's very kind of expensive for them and complicated to get connected to Kyiv. Now there are lots of issues being raised about the performance, about the quality of network, which have been discussed at the governmental level and business level. Now, jointly with the American company, would like to launch a pilot project which would enable us to have an objective evaluation of our network, to find gaps, to find weak points. And, of course, for many, the majority of the companies, it's too expensive to do it individually or independently. Therefore, we want to cooperate with Americans. And by the end of this year, we want already to pilot this project and to see to which extent it will be kind of useful. And now we try to implement DDoS. Some people say it's not a good idea, but once you start doing that, nobody wants to pay. Therefore, we'd like to provide a relatively cheap tool, mechanism for our customers, participants, who will, which will help them to protect themselves from DDoS. I believe that by the end of the year, we will be able to implement this. And with the development of the division, we have a request for multicast that our kind of TV companies could exchange their content. A little bit of adverts dedicated to our 15th year as a university. Now we have a special proposal. You can see some information on the slide here. If you are interested, please come to us. Thank you very much for your attention. To have an interactive kind of format. Please, Sasha. I didn't prepare myself. I didn't plan to speak, but just in case I took my presentation, but I'll try maybe to talk what and why. Because most probably those competitors mentioned by Mr. Borisov, this process started back in 2012 when a number of companies, a group of companies, couldn't find any support from that time administration of Internet Association, which is managing IX. And the time of clubs and the kind of public organizations, and it came to the end. And because we started to follow not communism but capitalism, we decided that it was the right time to kind of to create the commercial platform, to use the commercial platform. And we decided to create IXP based on the commercial background, let's say. And now this GigaNet is something like this. It looks like that. There are many different items there. It is connected to the fact that GigaNet is a kind of a dispersed network. We are present in Odessa, Kharkov, Donetsk, Moscow, and the nearest future we plan to enter Lviv and some another city. So we have 126 participants, network participants. Somebody came to me just recently, my manager, and said, no, now we have 150. It's a little bit outdated presentation. So we have 150 participants, 500 gigabits of traffic, and a number of portals you can see on this slide. So at the moment we encourage connection with the big ports. We have quite huge ports being connected to us, which makes us more flexible. I won't talk about the kind of basic opportunities. In each city there is a global exchange and local exchanges. Now, moreover, there is a possibility to kind of get access to the tunnel, to click Kian, and you can, for example, get fiance of wise of certain switches or city, or just in the network. It can be multicast, unicast. And they are available from point to point and multi-pointal. In case you create these lands, you are the owner of the these networks, and you can regulate those who are connected to this land, and you can see them in the list of available available members, and also requests. You can see requests that this or that person wants to add to your list, and you can choose whether you want accept or kind of non-accepted. There are quite huge opportunities on the filtering of the routes. There is very good statistics on top 20 autonomous systems. There are a number of ports, and you can look statistics in any dimension. This is the history of growth, present points, exchange through the road server. It's also well known to everyone. This is a hybrid exchange model. It can be done through the road server or private peering being organized by the VLANs. It can be also organized partially through the road server and partially through the community, with more complicated rules being followed. This is how the admin interface looks like. For a number of seconds, you can create a VLAN from one point, from any point to the other point. The statistical data. It can be diagrams, graphs, or figures in any possible dimensions. Firewall is this is a kind of if somebody knows of you what is FireSpec, this is a kind of similar presentation, but because it's not Cisco or Juniper, this mainly extreme switches. It has a little bit different format and a different protocol. And some of the basic, of course, options are not supported, but on the other hand, there are some extended options, opportunities. Why it's necessary? Because you can, with the help of JustPGA, announce, install VCLs for yourself or for any other external. Let's say you have 200 ports, and for these external 200 ports, you can, for example, kind of circuit the traffic on yourself. Why it's necessary to be done over the perimeter? Because it's already an opportunity. If, for example, you have a problem like tens of gigabits, you can't filter anything on your port. Otherwise, it will be overloaded. Therefore, and the further you put this filter from yourself, the better it works. This is again this interface. It shows you just submit BGP announce, and in 24 hours it will be just automatically be cancelled if you don't kind of approve it again or confirm it again. DDoS protection is not similar to ICL, and the schema is the following here. Now this service is kind of in the at this stage of testing trial. It's available only to a number of customers, but how it works? In fact, we circuit all the traffic, turn it from one port or VLAN to a special server farm. There are a number of like 60 servers that can perform different things with this traffic. That can dismantle it up to the seventh level, or can insert caps into them, any JavaScript tasks for bot networks. So how does it work? For example, you have a bot network, and at the seventh level, it tries to attack a website with the kind of search request, which means that this one of the most vulnerable things on the website, this is a kind of search line. And in case it will be used, it will be very difficult to filter this DDoS by network measures. It's very difficult, so it's necessary to dismantle it up to the seventh level. What we do, instead of first page of the website, we put JavaScript task. This task depends on the user agent. For example, bot network very often has been represented as Chrome, but it is not Chrome. in reality. And we know, for example, that the real Chrome could perform this Java task, and WebKit, on which this botnet was assembled, it can't perform this task. And therefore, those who don't perform this task based on their IP addresses, they will be blacklisted, and then this list is used for the firewall. By means of such kind of actions, we can do filtration for any traffic. And just recently introduced service, this is connectivity monitoring. This is pretty simple. So we take BGP announces from a big number of sources, and we have a kind of connectivity with the internet providers, and we can inform the officials there what of the links became available or non-available. It's clear that it can be implemented locally everywhere, but nevertheless, this is our new product, and it has been launched. It was launched, in fact, on the first of the current month. There are not many users so far. But it is yet connected that not many telephone numbers were in the contact list. So once you go to the admin interface and put your number, telephone number, into the contact, then you will be get access to such announce panel. There you can switch each of your PRC's condition status for a different period of time. Last mile, it's kind of peculiar service, doesn't has direct linkage to IX, but at some point we decided that we have to support not only technical network services, but also so-called cooperative services. This is, in fact, a specialized mailing list, how it works, that every member announces in which areas he works, indicating the exact area in the country, and then if, for example, you need a last meal, and this is quite often a request from big companies like, for example, Data Group or Viega. Bank approaches them and say, we need to connect that or this huge number of cash machines. And, of course, it's not very difficult to find one operator. So out of 350 operators available, he has to find and select 70 partners. It is very difficult to do it manually. So in GigaNet, he could go to the exchange panel, form the request there, and then the request will be automatically channeled to the location of each company provider. Let's say the sales manager will get this request, query, let's say, and we made it so that we don't have this correspondence through our server. It will be a reply to, will go to the original address. So it's kind of targeted to the localizations. It's quite popular service. We can see the number of queries and requests of this original request, and there is quite a lot of them. If somebody in Ukraine has an opportunity to connect to last mile, it's very good. Please do it. It's not only available for the members; it's available for any company. I also talk about the help desk 24/7. I try to do my presentation in 10 minutes. Do you have any questions, please? I'm impressed. I know a lot about GigaNet. I didn't know about Firewall. I didn't know about this dynamic Firewall being built on the JavaScript page. This is something very complicated. It's not very complicated, but this is the only way to protect from DDoS at the application level, because if you have this DDoS with the SIM packages, it's kind of outdated. It's a previous practice. Any questions, please? Andrei Tuzhik from Logolink, internet provider on in the East. Back in 2007, you talked about the switch, which looks like a box with ports. At which stage this development is now? We are now testing the equipment of company Kwanda in connection to this development, and in fact, the kind of to say, parts became available for the production only this year. Now we are testing this device. What I showed you now, like firewall and all this network relationship, is now all built based on the program scripts of some external additions or applications. We plan to do the following, that at the end of 2016 we plan the complete upgrade of our equipment. And once we do it, we are not going to procure any longer classical switches. Most probably we will buy bare metal switches without operational systems. We will download Linux, for example, on them, and then we will use it as software-defining tool. So it's going to be kind of a substructure, which is now existing above the classical switches. It will be transferred to this new soft. Of course, it will provide more flexibility, because then you can be very kind of accurate from the point of view up to the package. You also talked about your presence in other cities. Talking about routing in those cities, is it about routing, or is just access to your services from other cities? Or it's going to be based on the VLANs, or the traffic will be connected to Kyiv and then rerouted somewhere. How is built now? It's built like that in Odessa and Moscow and Donetsk and in Kharkov. So look, you can switch and get port. And there is a number of VLANs on this port available. You can say there is one global VLAN. This is a global exchange of everybody with everybody. We have local exchange in each city, like, for example, Odessa, there is its own a local exchange, in Lviv its own, in Kyiv its own, etc., etc. So this is kind of local exchange within the boundaries of the city. Within this VLAN, there is a kind of a separate road server announces, so there is a change within the limits of the city. Plus, there are different private peering VLANs, which you can also use. So, based on the, you have a kind of quite flexible and simple control panel, and now you can decide what you can circuit inside this switch, what you will circuit inside the network, what you would give out for the private peering. This is for, like, under private peering, this is a typical service, like, for example, these are the companies which build huge headends. They can get satellite channels, and of course it's very expensive. The real one would cost more than $1 million. So they have this flow which they want to sell. What they do? They take VLAN in GigaNet and indicate this as a like TV flow multicast. That many channels, for example. You can see this VLAN in your control panel. You can switch the button to switch in, and you can get information that this VLAN belongs to this or that company, and we're going to send them a request. Send them a request, they reply to you and say, yes, it is possible, we can switch you in by one click. It's going to cost you, let's say, 1,000 hryvnias a month. I don't know the prices exactly. This is the policy of each individual company. Therefore, they use our infrastructure for selling their services. I'd like just to give a couple of minutes for those people who had no presentation. Maybe Sergey Gudinov. I can see you have only one platform now. You cooperate with GigaNet, but maybe briefly you can explain us how it works. Yeah, my name is Sergey Gudinov. It's an Odessa network of internet exchange. The company was based, was launched in 2007. And now we are the partners of GigaNet company. Before that, we were dealing with the local traffic. These are all data related to 26, but yeah, that's very kind of, tentative data. That's why they're marked with the ASIC. Now we're kind of technical platform for not only GigaNet, but also for DataNet and many other companies. And also we are kind of providers. We are just a classical IX, Internet Exchange Point. So it's mentioning that you are the platform for getting connection to other networks. Just briefly, there are more than kind of 1,000 fibers which are now switched to our platform. Many of them are occupied. These are different providers, different service providers from Odessa, Odessa region, Ukraine, foreign countries. We don't, let's say, subdivide people on the categories where they are from. Just one clarification or note. I'd like to say that this model of collaboration between GigaNet and local IXPs is, we say, level 2 and level 3, and all upper levels we kind of do deal with them ourselves, and level 1 we leave for our local partners and provides them an opportunity to gain money from this level 1. And for us, why it's useful for us, because it helps us to make the place more attractive. Because when I heard about this 600 freakies occupied, it's quite huge amount, even for Kyiv, not only for Odessa. Mikhail Sarikov, Digital Telecom Internet Exchange. We've been and we are independent and neutral operators. We are very loyal to all our customers and to our potential customers. To the opportunity of being connected to us, we have a reselling kind of program. Everybody can do it. Everybody can provide detailed services at its territory. Those who want to switch to us from outside of the Ukraine and they have no opportunity to enter and to come to Kyiv physically, they can use KX remote access program. We have some operators which are our partners and they deal based on this formula, and in fact they can switch anyone who wants remotely. What we did, what is good about us is that we collected more than 30,000 prefixes. Out of those, more than 20,000 are best. I mentioned last time in the previous report, you can see the even the composition, the list of those prefixes. Yeah, of course we use. So you can see what is their composition, who are the participants, who are the participants in the IXPs. Our core is based on unblocked LX 16 switch fabric capacity 7 kilobits, and data forwarding capacity is 3 kilobits. So we have a very good capacities. We can grow. In Kyiv we are present in 5 points. Yeah, I agree with you that this is an outdated table. This is an outdated data. Of course, I will change it. So, and 350 kilobits as to the traffic and more than 120 participants. We have Juniper section. We have one router and we will get another one soon. We'll install a second one, so it's gonna be a junior routing pad and switch extreme.
That And then please say a few words. So what I noticed that IX is now a platform. So basically, it's not just a place with a switch or many places with many switches. It's a place where you can come and sell your services and you can buy. So I think Giganets as an example, how you can use that to facilitate your customers coming to you and buying everything at one place. It's almost like a internet market. It's not just a product of it's not just a route server. So tell me what you do, and I see you have where is your 86 locations and 500 numbers. This is way more than every other exchange in Ukraine together.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. Well, let me first start with how internet exchanges developed.
Maybe closer to this.
A little bit closer. Internet exchanges started with one switch in one data center. Then they evolved into multiple data centers, connecting them. We've taken it one step further. So instead of going into a metro, we go wide area. And we are now connecting multiple countries instead of multiple data centers inside a city. With this solution, we go towards the potential members that want to connect to us, that don't have the money to go to the big cities. And I think this is the next level of internet exchanges, where anybody can connect in any data center. Currently, we are in 86 data centers. Hopefully, by the end of this year, we will have about 100 data centers connected in about 13 countries. And that creates a lot of opportunity for everybody to interconnect IP traffic. If that's on peering or if they use VLANs for direct interconnects. And it also allows a lot of other businesses to develop their tools and products to use our layer 2 platform to present them to the other members.
Thank
you. Maybe you can also say correct data about yourself, because how many members you have, how many points you have about your traffic. I don't remember, of course, figures by heart, but just in a couple of words about our company. We are IX company. This is the first pipe IX, distributed IX, which operates in Ukraine, Russian Federation, Kazakhstan, Belarus, and Frankfurt. We have presence points in all those countries, and we switch connect to national operators. We have presented in all huge cities in Russian Federation, in Minsk, in Kyiv, in Astana, Frankfurt. We are present with our hardware, with our equipment, and maybe that's why we are being liked by different networks and people who are oriented on work with the content. Summary traffic data, we have around 2 terabits. We take second place in Russian Federation and in the world 6th or 7th as to the scope of traffic. Our nearest plans, so currently we try to develop the north in Tbilisi. We'd like to enter the Caucasian market by connecting Georgia and Azerbaijan, Armenian operators. Now we also negotiate with Iran in order to connect them to IX. As to the most important events in our activity, we have new members. This is China Telecom. Plus, they start peering with the help of their internal system, not external kind of for the global peering, but the internal system. As to our equipment, our core is based on the equipment of the cloud gene company, quite powerful switches. There is a presence of 100 gigabit ports in our regions. In the regions we use Juniper and Extreme as well. We have a separate legal entity in Frankfurt. They will mainly work with the content like DigitalOcean and Kastner, the all our customers. And our European node hub has been rapidly developing. That's just briefly about also. So in fact, you can be also kind of an alternative transit for Frankfurt. Let's say our Ukrainian branch is not yet connected to our European Internet Exchange point. That's why we don't announce European connectivity, as it's going to be quite a long route. It should go through Peter, Frankfurt, Sogorim, Moscow, Kharkov, Kyiv. It's a kind of huge hook. It's quite long. For example, Giganet going to enter Frankfurt. Okay, I won't compare you. Yes, of course, we do have plans to kind of increase the capacity up to the levels in Frankfurt. Of course, our service maybe is not that highly technological and customer-oriented and intellectual, like my colleagues from Giganet have. I am very impressed by what they have done and what they developed. We have just a simple IX, which of course has its own community, VLANs and private peers and things like that. My name is Vyacheslav Volk. I represent Khmelnytsky Internet Exchange Point. When I look on those figures, I'm a kind of anti-port in this regards. But when Dima invited me to participate in this panel, I did agree, because I think that my mission here, this panel, is to say that apart from the big players at the market in Ukraine, there are also local internet exchange points, and we still survive. Of course, we have a kind of small amounts of traffic, but from this or that point of view, it's very useful to the region, to the development of infrastructure. For the recent 2 years, for example, we created a technical platform. We started to install some fiber optic, and in order to prepare the infrastructure, because in пропадает звук.
There are no plays. There's no content. There is some kind of there's a breaking in the microphone's work. It disappears. All right. Well, I'm saying that these small figures, they show the objective reason. We can't fill the AX with anything. Therefore, we're performing certain works there, so maybe we'll be the LA1 transport to provide services to other IXs. Basically, that's it. So, essentially, you'll be a platform of access for the access, just like works in Odessa. Any questions from the audience, maybe? Yes, please. I'd like to boast a bit. There are so many nice stuff being said about Giganet. I would like to say about UIX as well, because we also have things to boast. We are actually doing the same things. Well, Giganet are moving faster towards such advanced goals, but we are catching up, actually. We are not as bad as... It's not a shock of detail, AX. Well, asking provocative questions, I can't, because I'm a stakeholder, I'm a minister of party, but I'd like to support Slava and comment on his remarks. Really, it doesn't matter. The traffic volume is not important. It's far from the most important successful performance indicators for the AX. One of the tasks is not to leak the CDN content, for example. The most important purpose for the AX is to give the peers to provide a high-quality service to its clients. That's why the more prefixes you have, the more peers you have, even without the growth in traffic, then it means you are growing. It is always better from Antinopi directly to Khmelnytsky without going through Kyiv. So develop, advance your IX. With the growth of regional operators, the interest to your IX will grow as well. Yes, I agree, we don't want to shut it down, we don't plan to shut it down. I just want to actually support you, to encourage you. Don't worry for the traffic volume, don't worry for that. Yes, I have a reminder here on the slide, the growth in the crisis times. Since the economy of country is not growing, actually, you know, about the exchange rates problems, it's inflation, etc. Maybe, were there any focuses or ways to somehow react upon the economic crisis? Maybe you have some know-how. Maybe how did the economic crisis affect you? Maybe you invented something in the context of the economic crisis on the national level. Yes, I have one secret, but it's an old secret and not complicated. You just must work. I'd like to support you, yes, Sasha. One must work, one must introduce new services, and then the market will be revived with our support. There are no other recipes. One must be introducing something new. This is the only way to revive the market. I think that in such hard times as these, we should not resort into crazy dumping, and we shouldn't increase the tariff rates. We should at least keep a stable pricing policy, at least.
Well, in economic hard times, why won't an IX go to the next data center so they can connect with the people in that data center that don't have the money to go to the other data center where there is an IX? So an IX can play an important role in interconnecting and improving the internet.
Also, I'd like to say that in principle, we managed to unite the Eastern Europe and Western Europe, and the IX exchange point is a good alternative to unite these geographical parts. But as regards the economic hard times, maybe we shouldn't be thinking about somebody else's money. We should think about how we can make some money. And there's a very good proverb: if you've saved money, it means you earned money. So on the uplinks and on the uplinks, one can save some money. For example, well, colleagues, I agree with Alexander Roshansky that one must work better and more. But as regards our exchange points, every IX becomes more interesting due to the growing number of participants. So we must create such conditions for our participants so that the inclusion into IX would be appealing from the traffic volume standpoint and additional services standpoint that it could provide. We've got like 10 minutes left, and maybe there are questions in the audience. Yes, please. Yes, the data group Evgeny Kashev. In these 2 days, we heard a lot of IPv6, a lot of stuff about IPv6, but none of the exchange points has mentioned the advancement of its IPv6 traffic. It would be nice, actually, to see on this table some reference to the IPv6, the comparison of the volumes of traffic via IPv6, the amount of the autonomous systems. I'm not happy that I started with this table. Now I'll have to be updating it till the end of my life, God's sake. And now, just like a wish from my side, to GigaNet IX, you start defending from DDoS, protecting from DDoS. It would be nice if you had some statistics of these activities, and we share it with the participants as to the botnets in your framework, like some parasite traffic. So maybe you could be some kind of a curator for you as a radar service. Thank you for your desire. We will definitely write down into our future request lists. I can't promise a fast performance because the queue is long there in this list. As to the IPv6, well, look, when I for the first time heard of IP protocol in general, there were some talks already about IPv6 at that point. It was like in 1996. Today it's 2015, and so 19 years passed, soon to be 20. And my opinion on this is very simple. We are all involved in the network technologies for a long time now. If in our business a certain technology didn't advance in 20 years, it will not advance at all in the future. I don't believe in IPv6 at all. Maybe you might not like this, but this is true. It's just an opinion. Any other comments? Borisov, maybe Mr. Borisov, as to the IPv6. We don't have many requests on IPv6, unfortunately. Therefore, I'm not ready to speak about the IPv6 traffic going through our IX. Maybe in the near future we'll ask our IT experts to draw such a graph so we could compare. But I think that its volumes are very small. Yeah, its volumes are not large in the world as well. We have less than 1%. With IPv6, there's another bad problem. In 20 years, neither the first, nor second, nor third, there was supposed to be three generations of people who would understand how this works. And also, I know all the nuances of this process. And we don't have that. Boris, please.
Понятно. Борис, пожалуйста. Okay. You do this, and then he'll do that.
Okay. On IPv6. Traffic is increasing, and we encourage all our members to do both IPv4 and IPv6 peerings on the route server, on direct peerings, and it is a necessity. It might not be needed today in this part of the world, but there are parts in the world where there is no more IPv4 space. So being prepared and making it work is really important.
So out of your terabyte, how much traffic you have on V6? I mean, it's 1.2 terabytes. terabytes, sorry.
Traffic volumes is still low because, like I said, everybody...
It's 1%?
It's okay. It's less than 5%.
Okay.
Well, actually, while I was waiting, you already said everything that I wanted to say. Well, you know, you can't be enjoyed if somebody doesn't want you to enjoy. But there's no demand, that's what I'm saying. I'd like to ask the person who asked the question, what can you advise to the IXS to advance this topic that you're insisting on? Maybe you could give an answer. What we should do for this? Maybe you could answer. Just express yourself. We will bring the statistics out. We will publish statistics. For IP6? Well, for example, the free of charge inclusion into the IPv6, the participants. And you will pay to us for this. If we speak of the development, well, you ask me. There's no development without money. It's a miracle. Well, you asked me how to increase the traffic. I answered, but I can't tell you how to make the money of it. These are two different things. I know how to increase the volume of traffic on IPv6, but not how to make money on it. I just looked intentionally. The technology was standardized in 1985, and Ethernet was 12 years old, so 30 years past. Is that what you're trying to say? Well, Ethernet, following your approach, the Ethernet was not supposed to advance as well. I didn't get it. What was the age of who and where? I would like to argue about Ethernet, actually. I wanted to debate. What are the age averages there? Ethernet, 1973, SDH, 85. But between 73 and 85, how many years passed? 12. But I'm sorry. In 1985, I had Ethernet already. I also had it. But Ethernet in global networks didn't grow in 1985. It appeared later, but it was not for global purposes invented. But now it's there. That's what I'm saying. All I'm trying to say is that the technologies, you know, they are complicated. They are sophisticated. Well, yes, of course, you can, in the former USSR terms, in Russia, Ukraine, you can ignore the global trends and say that, yes, we're not interested in what was told to us 3 hours ago. We're not interested in 10% of the IPv6 of Google. Already 10? I saw 8%. All right, 8. But the doubling of traffic is not interesting for us. Yes, you can say that, but is it sensible? Is it a sensible position? I mean, probably it's a rigid situation, you know. We don't trust into what's happening in the world, but I think it's counterproductive. I'm not offering any solutions. I'm not offering any activities. I'm just, you know, offering to change the state of mind. Yes, we have very few IPPS experts still, but it's growing. I would like to add, I don't agree with Alexander as regards the IPv6, because we try to introduce in the city, on the hotspots, to give to the end user the IPv4 and IPv6 with a dual stack, and our traffic was distributed in half into halves, got divided into halves due to what was given by Google and YouTube, and all content there. Like contact here, and the users who would support the phone on the mobile device, in principle, it worked on IPv6 already. And the main obstacle here is not the ISP, it's not the ISPs, and not the equipment of the network operators, but the equipment of the users. Let's say the very home router, like TP-Link, in principle, following its hardware specifications, it can support IPv6. If it can be updated, it can work, but the very manufacturers is not interested in it, because the new switches will not be bought from him. That's why I think this is the main obstacle. Well, first users and then providers, but IX is not provided, is not is serviced by other people. But if the provider hasn't introduced this, one must introduce the billing for it. I mean, one must spend money on it. But the IX doesn't serve the traffic in Google. IX and the traffic is the traffic between the providers, because if none of them have the IPv6, the source, and maybe somebody have the client of the IPv6, but they don't have traffic between each other. They will go to Google or YouTube. They will not go via the IX. Yes, but when you connect the client, you offer him the to get connection on the IPv6. If, of course, he has... You won't believe it, but this is what we do. There's no demand for this bullion. There's no demand for this soup. Can I say something? But look, again, I didn't say that we don't provide the IPv6 service. I didn't say that. Please, all the services are accessible on the IPv6 level, but... There's no demand. Google is connected to us. I didn't know where you took 8% for. Maybe Google has certain policy on it. It doesn't give IPv6 traffic to us, actually. It does not. Or maybe it's not demanded from it. I don't know how it looks like, but Google is connected to us. And in terms of cache and direct connection, we don't see this traffic. Yeah? Now, again, I wanted to say something important. Look, I've been dealing with it for 20 years now. My trust or mistrust, it's one thing, and the services that we offer is different, right? But I want to say that the problem with the V6 is not a problem of a technical nature. It's a problem of the educational and economic nature, but not technical nature. Quite recently, I didn't just want to give some names, a very large Ukrainian provider, which has got like tens of hundred thousands of users on it, he recently told me that they ordered from Zixel a special firmware for its switches, out of which the IPv6 is totally eradicated. I asked him, why did he do that? And he responded, firstly, nobody uses that. Secondly, it takes lots of space. And thirdly, it's got gaps in it. And my administrators have better understanding of these gaps. Why should I waste my time on it if I'm fine? Everything works fine with IPv4. That's my, you know. In fact, I think the problem is more of economic and a professional training nature. You know, we can get traffic from everywhere. You know, do you know how Google raised the global SSL encrypted traffic? Do you know why in the world the SSL traffic grew? You know why? It didn't grow, but now started growing. Very simply, Google started raising in the search giveaway the web pages that have got the SSL certificate, you see? And clearly, it's an economic leverage which made everybody to go to SSL. With which objective it was done, you know, it's another question. Now, there is no interest, there's no stakeholder that would like to promote IPv6. Maybe the stakeholder will appear, I do not know. Oh, we've got some people now. The operator that eradicated from its firmware the IPv6, I'm ready, like in 3 years, I will argue, when IPv6, this operator will come to your parliament to forbid IPv6. I tell you, this is how it's going to be. Not it will happen in this case, but as you guys in 3 years, I've been hearing this for 20 years now. That's why the perspectives of several years is not efficient. I've got reports after lunch. My topic has no reference to this topic, but I think that this conversation, we should continue there. Yes, we are intercrossing there. Yes, your remark and then, not you. Well, in principle, it's not a question. I would like to share a case. Like last week, one of our clients, it's a hosting provider. It moved from one platform to another, one site to another. And as an IP link, he didn't raise the IPv6 because of his remove. I mean, he wanted IPv4 to work properly and without IPv6. And during an hour, his clients already make his cell phone hot because IPv6 email wouldn't work because he had IPv6 and the connectivity was lost and the service by demand, by default, were entering the IPv6. So I had this case, like, really? Did you want to say something? And you'll be the last speaker. We've been talking about DDoS today, and now we talk about IX now. Which one of you filters on a client? The spoof checks the legitimacy of AS prefix, AS prefix, and filters all that doesn't belong there. I can answer in the following way. The problem is not technical, you can filter it. The situation is the following. AX is a model of a service. There are various approaches to this, but our approach is the following. We give instruments for such filtering, but we will not filter ourselves, because we do not understand why. Roughly speaking, this traffic is good. I mean, the traffic is circulated. I can't say whether it's good or bad, and what the user uses with this traffic. It's his traffic, not ours. This is our approach. The instrument for that exists, of course. One can filter whatever. I agree with Alexander. Our approach is the same, because we do not know whether this traffic is good. We can analyze whether it's good or bad, or is it DDoS or not DDoS. You know, that's why there is an instrument, but you decide what to do with it, how to filter it or not filter. It's not even an issue about good or bad traffic. It's an intrusion into somebody else's sovereignty. It's a breach of others' sovereignty. The question was actually about something different, and I will answer. The question was the following. Whether you check the conformity of the prefix to the origin of the place where that he came from, in order to avoid initially generated, do you check that? I answer. We don't do this now because the software that we use as a root server can't comprehensively do the RPKI checks. As soon as we have this implemented, we will do this. Yes, thank you. And now we're going to finish our panel here. I thank all the participants. We're going to have lunch now. The beginning of this next plenary session, 1500.